name is Ann Stamps. I'm very proud to be the Upper Cumberland Regional Chair for the Tennessee Suicide Prevention Network. I'd like to welcome you to the 15th annual Upper Cumberland Light to Hope. Historically, this event has been held live and in person, but with COVID-19, we chose this platform to ensure safety for everyone. September has been declared Suicide Prevention Awareness Month. Our goal for this event is to offer hope to those who are struggling with thoughts of suicide or have lost a loved one to suicide. Our wish is for all those who are watching will find hope.
Hello, and welcome to the Light to Hope event for suicide prevention for the month of September. We're going to begin with a prayer. Would you bow with me? Father, we are so thankful for all that you're doing around us every single day. And Father, we are thankful for the Tennessee Suicide Prevention Network and everyone who devotes a tremendous amount of time to learning and to helping and to driving hope in the lives of those who have been impacted by suicide and also those who struggle with mental health. And Father, we pray a special prayer over this event, over this month, and over all the work that takes place every single day throughout the year. And Father, we come to you. And we ask that you provide the hope, that you provide the way and the means. And Father, please do what you do best and make connections. And Father, we know that that if we'll lean into that, that absolutely incredible things are going to happen. And Father, help us to have open eyes. Help us to have open ears and open hearts, full of love and full of compassion for those that we interact with, those that we have relationships with, and to keep our eyes open for ways to help, ways to encourage, and ways to live beside each other every day. And Father, help us to enjoy life together and help us to build each other up. And Father, I pray a special prayer over this this month, and I pray that you will allow opportunities for education to be continued and for those who are weak, those who need help, those who are struggling. Father, please strengthen everybody who needs your help. And Father, please strengthen us. Please strengthen me. And Father, we all need you in basic and incredible ways all together. Father, we love you. We praise your holy name. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hey, everybody watching the Light to Hope event. My name is Jake Hoot, and you know, with September being Suicide Prevention Month, I thought I would play one of my songs that's one of my favorite inspirational songs, and it's an old song. I think it's either by Bill Withers. I think it's Bill Withers that sang it. But anyway, here's Lean On Me. Y'all sing along. In our lives, we all have pain, we all have sorrow, but if we are wise, we know that there's always tomorrow. Lean on me when you're to lean on. y'all for watching.
Hi, I'm State Representative Kelly Keisling. We all feel nervous and uncertain about things sometimes. Remember, you won't always feel this way. We have people that can help 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. The National Suicide Prevention Lifeline is a hotline for individuals in crisis, for those looking to help someone else. To speak with a certified listener, please call 1-800-273-8255. This world is a better place with you in it.
My name is Janie Mabrey, and this is my daughter, Andrea Thompson. We're here to share our story of our journey as survivors of suicide loss. We lost my son and Andrea's brother, Matt Mabrey, to suicide in 2013. Suicide ends the physical life of one person, but it forever changes the lives of all of us who are left behind. We are the survivors. To me, a survivor was someone who still exists after an event in their life that could have destroyed them. I didn't feel like a survivor. We are left to continue living, but life looks different than before the suicide. And that's how we measure time now, before the suicide and since the suicide. Nothing in our lives is the same as before the suicide. We have had to hear things, see things, decide things, and do things that we should never have to do. A parent should never have to choose a burial site for their child. A parent should never have to stand on the tarmac at an airport and watch his flag-draped coffin moved from the cargo space of an airplane to a hearse. When my 31-year-old son died by suicide, I was blindsided. I equate the overwhelming mental pain of being notified of Matt's death to the physical pain and damage I would have experienced if I had been hit in the head with a baseball bat. I was confused, dazed, and in the worst pain of my life. The notification, words that a parent should never have to hear. In the early days of shock, there were so many details to attend to, so many decisions to be made, and too many questions that had no answers. There were too many hard things for my mind to reconcile. What is true? What is real? What happened? Where did I fail? What should I have done? Why didn't I do something or anything differently? Why didn't I see it? What did I miss? And then there were the nevers that my mind couldn't reconcile. The things that would never happen. Those texts and emails, phone calls, plans, stories. Just hearing his voice, hearing him play the guitar or his piano. Would there have been a wedding or grandchildren? He was gone. How could I comprehend that he was never coming home? Those questions were grouped with, what do I do now? How do I survive this? How do I go on? Will I ever be able to live like a normal person again? As survivors, we are told to pull it together and carry on. No matter what one has dealt with up to this point, everything is now questionable. Life is complicated. Nothing is normal. Nothing is absolute. The future seems abstract, and the past is just questionable memories. In an early journal entry, I wrote, "This morning I don't want to think or move. It's hard to wake up tired, overwhelmed, and in mental pain. I can't see a future, but I sense a future." Survivors are told to move forward, that it may take years to transition to the new normal. We must learn to manage the pain because it is now a part of our lives. How do we move on from here?
I lost my brother, Matt Mabrey, to suicide 6 years ago. I talked to him 2 days before he died. We laughed till we cried. We made plans for Christmas. We were completely normal. I had no idea that would be the last time I would talk to him. I once wrote in my journal that having my brother in my life was like growing up with a magical, mythical creature as my sidekick. He was funny, artistic, musically talented, and the most thoughtful gift giver on earth. We were opposites. And as a result, I don't remember us fighting or being jealous of each other. He was one of the only people that I've ever loved unconditionally. Before Matt's death, I'd experienced grief, or at least I thought I had. But the deaths of extended family members by natural causes did not prepare me for the experience of unexpectedly and tragically losing my brother at 31 years old. My previous experience with grief taught me that life has an order and a time for every season, and that time heals all wounds. The loss of my brother sent my brain and my body into shock and pain that I knew I wouldn't survive by just allowing time to pass. I didn't know that grief of this magnitude comes in waves because my brain and body couldn't absorb the full force of it all at once. I didn't know that I would be exhausted because my brain would spend all of my waking hours and many of my sleeping hours trying to make this situation fit into a mold that matched any previous mold in my brain. The pain of grief for me was a physical stomach pain and an emotional wish to be able to hide under the bed, then maybe even under the floorboards. I wanted to find anywhere that the crashing waves of grief wouldn't annihilate me. Nothing on earth felt right or safe to me anymore. I had no roadmap to navigate this experience, and I felt like I was going crazy. So I started asking others, will I ever be okay again? If you're asking yourself that question right now, let me be the first to tell you, yes, you will be okay. You have experienced one of the worst things that can happen in human life. Your life is forever changed, but you will survive this, and you will feel happiness again. I can't tell you exactly what that journey will look like for you, but we can share our experiences with you. We refer to this process as doing the work.
The day after Matt died, my husband Ray and I began searching for resources. We knew this was something we could not handle without professional help. With broken hearts and minds, we searched for referrals for therapists, for counselors, for support groups, self-help books, books about suicide, and other people who had suffered loss from suicides. We found that no one session or conversation gave all the hope we wanted. At the very first group session that we attended, the facilitator was angry and bitter, 13 years out from the suicide loss of his son. We had to keep searching for help and hope, not wishful thinking kind of hope, but an expectation for something better. But it was at that very same first group session that I learned to plan for those special days, holidays and birthdays, because every family tradition had to be reconsidered. My birthday and Mother's Day are among the hardest days that I've had to learn to endure instead of celebrate. No gifts, no cards, no phone calls came from Matt, and the feeling of loss was heavy. Eventually, with doing the hard work and learning to refocus my thoughts through prayer and support, I'm now able to redirect my thoughts on those days, and now I can actually think about how blessed I am to have Andrea and to have had Matt for 31 years instead of feeling the loss on those days. And then one counselor told me I probably wasn't praying enough. I had to agree with her, but my mind couldn't formulate sentences, so how was I expected to explain to God what was going on in my life? But it was in that session that I learned how not to fight against my emotions, and try not to stuff them down, but to set aside time for feeling and for grieving. We came away from every session with what I refer to as nuggets, small bits of helpful advice or words of validation and encouragement. I clung to anything that sounded helpful. If it was going to help, I was going to try it. We kept searching for suggestions, and we collected helpful tools, information that we have taken out of our grief toolbox and used over and over. like this is the hardest thing you'll ever have to do. Be patient with yourself and do not try to do this alone. Know that you can survive this even when it feels like you can't. With grief comes feelings of shock, guilt, blame, anger, depression, and isolation, and they're intertwined with feelings of love and loss. These emotions are overwhelming, but know that they are normal. One therapist told us, you hurt big because you love big. And to seek out people who are willing to listen without judging. Remember that many people are affected by suicide. And we learned about self-care. Take care of yourself, physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. Get enough sleep, try to eat right, get some exercise, pray or meditate, and journal.
I started individual therapy within a few weeks of my brother's death. I had a wonderful therapist who gave me homework assignments. These assignments might be something as simple as searching for a beautiful picture of scenery to use as a background on my phone to remind me that there is still beauty in the world. I was like an infant learning to navigate the world again. I was in a new world. Nothing about my old world made sense any longer. The homework assignments gave me control over one small thing in a world that had no control or order. She also told me to start a gratitude journal focusing on small things, a warm day, a beautiful sunrise, a good cup of coffee. All reminders that tiny good things were still happening around me. I also began writing letters to my brother. There was no one on earth who would understand how much I missed him, so I told him on paper. I also gained from therapy the ability to control or compartmentalize my grief when I was working. My job was an escape for me. It was the only time that I felt like my old self. That didn't stop the grief from attempting to crush me at times. If I were in a meeting and felt my mind or emotions headed to a sad place, I could picture a stop sign in my mind or pat my hands on my desk and say the word stop and take a deep breath. This would refocus my mind on the present. The biggest breakthrough in my personal journey came from a sibling support group. Everyone's experience of grief is different, but I found a connection with siblings based solely on the sibling relationship and the intricacies that no other relationship has. A sibling is the only person in one's life with the potential to span your entire life. Parents typically leave us during our adulthood, and spouses aren't present for our childhoods. Losing a sibling is simultaneously losing your past and your future. Being in a room with other people who were voicing not only the same sadness, but the same fears about the future that I felt was a relief. It was the first time that I didn't feel alone. I also found that my experience and the nuggets that I had learned could be helpful to others at different stages in their journey. There are no guidelines or instructions on proper grieving. But the more information I shared with others, the more tools we each had in our toolboxes. In the beginning, I wanted someone to give me a version of hope that seemed attainable and wasn't just a hope for a new normal. I didn't want to think about a new version of life that didn't involve my brother. What I wish someone could have told me is this. There will come a time when you aren't constantly exhausted and sad. There will come a time when you can talk about your brother with people who didn't know him. There will come a time when you have more good days than bad days, and you'll learn that even your worst days are only temporary. In the beginning of this experience, I didn't dare pray for happiness. My goal was to feel any emotion other than soul-crushing grief. My first prayer was for boredom. I prayed that God would send me a mundane Tuesday. Years into this journey, I do experience boredom again, and I have mundane Tuesdays. The difference is that now I've learned to be grateful and smile to myself when that happens. When I think about my last conversation with my brother or read his old emails, I can laugh at his jokes instead of crying over his absence. Now when I'm sad that he's missing out on our big Christmas breakfast, I remember that the sadness I feel is the price I pay for having loved someone that much, and I wouldn't trade that for anything. I don't have everything figured out, and I'm still growing and evolving. These days I find myself praying for purpose and a future, and I can't think of anything more hopeful than telling myself in the beginning that one day you will again be able to focus on your purpose and your future.
Much later on the journey, I realized that the grieving and the healing were two separate things for me. I grieved the loss of my son, and I will never get over that loss. In addition to the grieving loss, at some point, I had to begin the healing process for myself. I had to find a way to make life make sense again. I learned that healing takes time, but time does not heal. From my experience, I look back and see that it's the hard work and the effort made over time that aids in healing. Self-care began with very small steps. On bad days, getting up and getting dressed, or a move from the couch to the kitchen was a win. I found in my journal where I had written after a session with one therapist, "I am heartbroken but hopeful. If I can learn ways to heal from the trauma, I will be better able to grieve. Please, God, help my maze mind so I can grasp the situation. The facts hurt so bad. The facts hurt too bad to think, to breathe, to look forward, or to look back." And then I noticed at the bottom of the page I had scribbled the words, "Do something good for someone else." Excuse me. I found that helping others helped me. About 3 years into this journey, I became a peer mentor with TAPS, Tragedy Assistance Program for Survivors. I tell my mentees to ask me any questions from my experience, and I will answer them truthfully. When their hard questions came, I had to mentally take myself back to that point in my journey. It was from answering those questions for other mothers that I began to realize that I had moved forward. I had been where they were, but I had moved forward from that place in my journey. In recent weeks, I had another big mama meltdown, the first in a long time. And as is often the case, it came from a trigger that I wouldn't have suspected, and it hit hard. I could hear loud sobs coming, and it sounded like they were from someone else. But somewhere in my mazed mind during that time, I was able to reach for tools and tell myself, "This is temporary. You will come out of this darkness. Allow yourself to grieve your loss, and then reach for the hope." I came to the realization that I would never be the same as I was before the suicide death of my son, but I would be okay because I'm a survivor.
No! Thank you. business is no longer in the hands of someone else.
I realized that what other people said about me reflects who they are, not who I am.
Suicide doesn't take your pain away. It just passes it on to everyone else. It's okay to be a work in progress.
Sharing your feelings does not make you weak. Some days are still such a struggle.
All I can think of is Ben. I wish he kept living.
I decided to ask for help instead of going through it alone.
It was hard as hell, but I kept living.
I fought hard for hope rather than fall easily to despair.
One person took the time to listen and understand. Sometimes that's all it takes.
I kept living, and I hope you do too.
Hello, this is Michael Anderson, Upper Cumberland Regional Director for the Tennessee Suicide Prevention Network. I want to thank you for attending our virtual pre-recorded Light to Hope. Each year, the network recognizes one individual or organization who has went above and beyond to promote suicide awareness and prevention across the region. It's my honor to recognize Power of Putnam as this year's Upper Cumberland Regional Award winner. Alongside their mission of substance abuse, recognition, and awareness, and prevention, Power of Putnam has worked tirelessly alongside TSPN to raise mental health awareness and suicide prevention. Congratulations to Power of Putnam, and thank you for all that you do. We also have a second award winner in the region this year. For the Statewide Media Partner Award, the network recognized Stonecom Media. Throughout 2019 and 2020, Stonecom aired many PSAs, panel discussions, and individual interviews to promote mental health awareness and suicide prevention across the region. Congratulations, Stonecom, and thank you so much for all that you do. I also want to say thank you to all of our volunteers who work tirelessly day after day, week after week, year after year, to make TSPN's mission of reducing stigma and raising awareness about suicide become a reality. Thank you, everyone, for everything that you do.
Say Hello, I'm State Senator Paul Bailey. According to a January study by the Centers of Disease Control and Prevention, farmers are among the most likely to die by suicide compared with other occupations. The National Suicide Prevention Lifeline is a hotline for individuals in crisis or for those looking to help someone else who is. To speak with a certified listener, call 1-800-273-8255 or call our local crisis team at 1-800-704-2651. We want you to know that you're not alone.
Hello, everyone. We want to give you a little bit of history behind the Love Never Dies Memorial Quilt Project and why we feel it is so important. The quilts help us remember that the number of deaths by suicide that we often talk about are much more than numbers. They are people. They are someone's daughter, son, wife, husband, brother, sister, mother, father, closest friend. They are a loved one that is now gone. The quilts are deemed necessary and important in order to personalize the phenomena of suicide and help us realize that suicide is a public health crisis. So the Tennessee Suicide Prevention Network decided to develop statewide quilts for use at public awareness events and then formed the Quilt Committee, which is made up of volunteers who are survivors of suicide loss. These individuals then in turn handle all aspects of the quilt project. They handle the logistics of the quilt squares, the design, and the assembly of the quilts themselves. The first of the Tennessee Memorial quilts was presented at the Suicide Prevention Awareness Day at the state capitol in September of 2006. Each year that followed, TSPN has been able to introduce at least one, if not two, quilts during the month of September. We now have 16 quilts, and the 17th quilt will be presented this year on September the 9th, with 19 new people being remembered. The Love Never Dies quilts are an ongoing project of TSPN, and its quilt committee will be accepting submissions indefinitely. Ms. Carol Chastain Beal has coordinated the quilt project since 2007. In 2013, the Upper Cumberland was gifted a signature quilt by Spring Creek Quilts. This quilt has been displayed and made available at multiple Upper Cumberland events and statewide events where loved ones are invited to write the name of the person they have lost on the quilt. So if you live in Tennessee, or if your loved one who died by suicide lived in Tennessee, you may request a quilt square be made in honor of that person. You can refer to the TSPN.org website for additional information on how to have your loved one included, or reach out to the TSPN Regional Director for the Upper Cumberland, Mr. Michael Anderson, for more information. Thank you so much.
Hi, my name is David Koci. I'm going to play a song for y'all called Sentimental Dream that I wrote. And Nathan Ridley's on guitar. Kate Rieder is on drums. And I just want y'all to think of all your options and choices, because when I think of mine, I have more hope. Some dream of the waters when there's not much that matters, when hearts can beat slowly and time loses meaning. But these current times are the highest contradiction to any valid submission of requestful paradise. Cause alarms will sound and gas will fill the tanks, and driven or consuming payments that are arranged, and the images of the past will fade into glory, and all who came before me will echo in the sentiment of dream. Will echo in the sentiment of dream. It's hard as my ethic drives me day to day, and will seasons pass? Could any of this last? The horizon in front of me is just a symbol of uncertainty. Cause alarms will sound and gas will fill the tanks, driven or consuming payments that are arranged, and the images of the past will fade into glory, and all who came before me will echo in the sentiment of dream. Will echo in the sentiment of dream. Traffic as we cross, I understand the permanence of time gone by, but love is never lost. Because alarms will sound and gas will fill the tanks of the driven or consuming payments that are arranged, and the images of the past will fade into glory, and all who came before me will echo in the sentiment of dream. will echo in the sentimental dream. Will echo in the sentimental dream. Will echo in the sentiment of dream. Will echo in the sentiment of dream.
This concludes our 15th annual Light to Hope. Thanks to all who watched and participated. A heartfelt thank you to our Upper Cumberland Regional Director, Mike Anderson, and all of our wonderful volunteers who work tirelessly toward our mission of suicide prevention in the Upper Cumberland. Thank you and take care.